Hey, check this out. It's the new Volkswagen ID3, really important electric car. Now in this video, I'm going to be driving it here from Volkswagen's headquarters in Milton Keynes all the way up the motorway until it runs out of charge, because I want to see how far it can actually go on a full battery. What exactly happens when it does run out of charge? Does it just conk out, leave you stranded? I'm going to find out, though a man from Volkswagen over there isn't too happy that I'm doing this test, but in the interest of motoring journalism, I'm going to do it anyway. And of course, along the way, I'm going to give the car a thorough reviewing to let you know if it's any good. This is a big moment, driving the new Volkswagen ID3 for the first time. The car's battery has 94% charge. It's a 58 kilowatt hour battery, and the full range, if it's fully charged, should be 260 miles. So based on 94%, hoping to get 240 miles. The car's computer is actually saying that it should do 176 miles, but that'll have been calculated based on whoever was driving it before. I've reset all the trip computers, so we are good to go and see how far we can drive this thing. Ooh, we're off. For this range test, I am just going to drive this car normally. I'm not going to be enthusiastic with the accelerator, but I'm not going to nanny it either. These cars, if they're going to work, are going to have to be driven the way you want to drive them. I'm also going to have the climate control on like I normally would. This is a real world test. We'll see what this car will do in terms of range if I was to drive it as I normally drive. Joining the motorway now for the long slog ahead. Oh yeah, classic M1. Instantly into some roadworks. Brilliant. That will help its range though, sticking at 50 miles an hour. I wonder if this car's got the cruise control and the limiter. Let's have a look. Yes, it has. Oh, and it's a clever system as well. So it's using a radar to keep me a safe distance from that car in front. It should have lane keeping assist as well. Oh, it's going to do that thing where it bounces you between the white lines. So it doesn't really hook you up dead central, which is annoying. You can't get away with letting go of the steering wheel in this car, and you can't confuse it like older systems, which would test if there was any kind of like weight being pressed up against the steering wheel, so you could just like add some weight to them and it would think, oh, someone's holding it. But with this new system, it uses similar technology to your mobile phone, which can tell when you're touching the screen, so you can tell when you're touching, actually physically with your hands, touching the steering wheel or not. And if you're not, yeah, it'll tell you off and then the system will disengage. Electric cars aren't actually at their most efficient when they're cruising on the motorway at higher speed. They're actually better when you're just in town doing stop-start stuff, because you don't have an engine chugging away. They can really maximise their value there. So we should test this car out in town, and I'm approaching Rugby, so I'm going to head to the centre and I can just use the sat nav of the ID3 to do that. And it's got voice commands, so I should be able to tell it to take me to the centre of Rugby, and I'll do that by getting it to direct me to the high street. So here we go. Hey ID, take me to the high street, Rugby.
Did you mean Sheffield or High Street 12?
The High Street, Rugby.
Please wait. Please say the street in Northampton first.
What? Get my phone, Lewis.
Did you mean boating?
No, I don't mean boating or vet. Boating or vet? What's this even on about? Just utter nuts. Cancel. Hey Google, take me to the High Street, Rugby. Look, there, it comes up with it straight away. So we've got to get off here. Now I would be running Android Auto through this car normally, but for some reason, these very first editions don't have Android Auto or Apple CarPlay. I don't know the reason, and neither did the man from VW. Anyway, you will be able to retrofit it to these first edition cars, and anyone who buys a series car, which comes later, so in the new year, it will have Apple CarPlay and Android Auto, and that'll be a good thing because, yeah, the voice commands on this. As you just saw, well, very good. Do you mind just holding your hand there, Lewis? Let's give it another go. Hey ID, take me to the High Street, Rugby.
Stromness, boy. Please say the name of the street.
How was what I said anything like Stromness Hoy? That'd have me going to Scotland. Now the voice commands are better at stuff like setting the temperature, for instance. Hey ID, set temperature to...
What can I do for you?
Set temperature to 25 degrees.
No problem.
Yes, it's done it. Thank God for that. We're coming off the motorway now. energy usage is 3.9 miles per kilowatt hour. I'm going to see if it goes up or goes down when I'm driving around town. I'm going to put this car into B mode. So what that does is increase the regenerative effect when you lift off the accelerator. So it slows the car down more without you having to touch the brake. I like that because it gives you more control. It's not as pronounced as it is in a Honda E. In fact, if you click on the pop-out banner up there, you can watch my full in-depth video review of the Honda E. Just going into a little tunnel. But it does just allow you to not use the brake so much. And that improves your efficiency, which is good. Now, the suspension doesn't feel quite as soft as in a Golf. It's a bit harder. That's because this car is heavier, so they have to increase the stiffness of the suspension to stop it leaning so much in the bends. But in no way is it uncomfortable. It's quite nice. Steering's light as well. Actually, this car's got a really good turning circle. It's just over 10 meters. It's slightly better than on something like a Kia e-Niro and a Tesla Model 3. Visibility is pretty good. This extra window here really helps. You've got a nice big windscreen. The window ledge isn't too high. The only issue is the view out the back isn't brilliant because the back window isn't very deep. It's my only complaint. Yeah, it is easy to live with and easy to drive. I haven't touched the brake at all yet. What's happening with the average energy consumption? It's still on 3.9, it hasn't changed. Anyway, let's head off up north again. I'm gonna give this ID3 another chance. Hey ID, take me to Leeds.
Did you mean Maidstone, Leeds?
No, I meant Leeds. Volkswagen, you need to sort this voice command stuff out because it's just utterly shit.
All I heard was a beep. Something must have been censored.
At least it has a sense of humour. We're on track now. Finished with the town section. Made no difference to our energy consumption. 3.9 miles per kilowatt hour. Based on that energy consumption, this car's range would be 226 miles. So a bit shy of the 260 it's supposed to do. I somehow managed to put that on. That's the trouble with these touch sensitive buttons. I've been noting I've been dabbing them accidentally when I've been touching the screen. So I'll just, look, you want the hazard lights to be like a real physical, I want to press this, I'm damn sure about it kind of thing. Especially when the indicators, while I do like them, they're rather quiet. Before we get back onto the motorway, which incidentally is just there, so you'll probably hear some cars whizzing by, I thought I'd pull over in this random car park to take in the ID3's design. It's a really nice looking car. It's futuristic enough without being too in your face about it, but you can tell it's an electric car and it's got a real face on it, hasn't it? And I want to show you this. When you unlock the car and it's dark, which I'll have to cover the light sensor there so you can see it, its eyes sort of wake up and look around. Have a look at this. Can you see them? They're like, all right, you got me. And it gives this car a personality. I like this light bar as well, which joins the two lights. It's got a definite face, a smiley, happy, cheery face. Obviously, there's no big grille because there's no engine under there that requires cooling. There are vents down here, though, which do help cool the drive system. Say, if you're using the batteries quite heavily, they will warm up and need cooling down a bit to be as efficient as possible. Let's move down the side. So you get 18-inch alloy wheels as standard. These are the 19s, though you can upgrade to 20s. You've got this black panel here, which matches the contrasting black roof, and you get two-tone paint on all models. And this shape also matches the spoiler. One thing I really like are the creases in the doors. Gives the car a really good shape, and you've got some side skirts here, which look sort of sporty. Moving to the back, there's one thing I don't like so much here, this decal. Now it changes depending on which version of the ID3 you have, though all of them are just stuck on. And this one's already coming away, look at that. The two-tone effect really looks great, doesn't it? You've got some sharp tail lights, obviously they're LEDs in there. It's a really nice looking car. I prefer it than the look of the Tesla Model 3, which looks a bit like a fish from the front. But what do you think? Let me know in the comments box below. Now we're back on the motorway. Let's talk through the ID3 range. So it's going to be available with three different battery packs. There's one with 45 kilowatt hours, which is good for just over 200 miles. This 58 kilowatt hour battery pack in this car, which as I said at the beginning, is good for around 260 miles. Then there's the range topping 77 kilowatt hour battery pack, which should be able to do 340 miles. Then there's three different motor choices. The entry-level motor has 126 horsepower and is good for 0 to 60 in about 10 seconds. Then there's a 150 horsepower motor, which should be able to do 0 to 60 in 9 seconds. And there's the motor in this car, which has 204 horsepower, which can do 0 to 60 in just over 7 seconds. Then there's seven different trim levels, with funny names, but you can't get each motor or battery combination with each trim level. It's all a bit confusing, and VW hasn't confirmed what's what yet. I thought I'd just take a break from driving to talk you through the interior design of this car. So I really like the look of it. It's smart, and it's lifted by the fact that you can get different colour combinations for the steering wheel and the dash top, which does just make it seem more interesting. What I'm not so keen on though is the build quality. So while this panel on the top of the dash is squidgy and expensive feeling, the rest of everything you touch is all pretty brittle and cheap plastic. And then there's the build quality itself and fit and finish, which isn't to the usual VW standards. Look at this glove box, it doesn't quite fit properly. This center console wobbles quite a bit. When I was removing our camera from here, I noticed that that comes undone. Oops, hopefully it's not broken, so I'll just leave that on there. There's some felt in the door pocket to stop things rattling around, though the amount of felt in there is less than in the door pocket of the old Mark 7 Golf. In fact, I think the interior quality of Volkswagen's very latest cars is less than the previous generation versions, partly because Volkswagen's having to cut costs because they were hit with such big fines for the whole Dieselgate scandal, and because they're running two model lines side by side, internal combustion engine cars and electric cars, and that just costs so much money to do. As a result, the inside of this car isn't as nice as a Tesla Model 3. Now, who'd have thought that Tesla would be doing better build quality than Volkswagen? In fact, if you want to see my full in-depth video review of that car, click on the pop-out banner up there. Anyway, let's move on to this infotainment system. So all cars get this screen as standard, and it's fairly nice and bright and easy to navigate. What I'm not so keen on though are the touch sensitive buttons for the audio, which it's very hard to just get it to do exactly what you want it, and the touch sensitive buttons for the climate control, and in the end you have to just press that button there and go into the normal climate, so it's one press too many really. It's frustrating. I do like this little digital driver's display. It's not big, but it gives you all the information you want, and you can change the view slightly depending on what you want to have bigger and smaller. That's good. What's not so good though are the touch sensitive buttons here. So listen, they make a noise and they vibrate when you swipe over them, but you can swipe them but also press them, and they click, and you're not sure what button press you're supposed to do. It should either just be a swipe, touch sensitive, or a press. Why have both? Can't complain about this though, look. That's the gear selector. VW has just copied that from a BMW i3, but it's in a brilliant position. I also like this, the way the instruments move with the steering wheel. Speaking of which, the driving position, yeah, it's good. And it's dead easy to get comfy. Lots of adjustment. What's not so great though is the location of the lights here. Why aren't they there like in other Volkswagen cars? You go for them and then you end up knocking the indicator. Who put them there? It's a bit of a shame really, because otherwise this car is quite practical. Look, big bottle fits in the door bin. Then you have a little net there for storing stuff. Got a cup holder here, big. Another cup holder here, big. Another storage tray down there, and specific place for your mobile phone with wireless charging. Then underneath here, there's more storage area, and you can move this divider about just as you want it. And you've got two USB-C inputs there. So if you've got an old-fashioned USB cable, you're gonna need an adapter. All's forgiven though because of this, look. Fold-down armrest in an electric family hatchback. It's the kind of thing you get in a Land Rover. I love it. I'm back on the motorway again. Now this time I've decided to take a back seat and let my cameraman Lewis have a drive. Now Lewis likes relaxed, laid back driving position, and he's over 6 foot tall. But despite that, I've still got a decent amount of knee room here in the back. Headroom is good as well. That's despite the fact that the batteries are underneath the floor, and that normally means that you end up with the back seat quite high. It doesn't affect this car. In fact, even if I move into the middle seat, look, still got enough headroom there, and there's plenty of room for everyone's feet as well, because the car's floor is completely flat. It's one of the benefits of it being an electric car and not an internal combustion engine car. What's also good is storage back here. So look, door bin has enough room for a bottle. There's also some pockets on the seat back, so they are a little bit loose, a bit like old knicker elastic. If I fold down this, you have an armrest with a couple of cup holders in there. It's a bit annoying that the cup holders aren't covered, so that when you rest on that, your arm ends up in there. It's not very comfortable. If I pull this down, we've got some through loading, so you can have two people either side and carry longer items such as skis, if ever you want to take your ID3 skiing. Then, if you look here, we have some Isofix anchor covers, so you can fit a child seat nice and easy. And because they don't actually pop out, these covers, you won't lose them. And there's enough space back here that it should be easy to maneuver even a big seat into position. There's a couple of USB-Cs down here for charging your mobile devices. The last thing for me to check is this. Will the back window go all the way down? Not quite, I'm afraid. But at least the window is big, so you get a good view out, and the window ledge is quite low, so even small children should be able to see out nice and easily. I'm quite impressed with the room back here. I think they've done a good job. I've jumped back in the driver's seat, and the car's just thrown up a warning. The lane departure doesn't seem to be working. Look, lane assist. Sorry, this function is currently unavailable. It's like, why is it currently unavailable? It was working before, now it's not. What's the point of having safety systems that don't work? When you have a destination programmed into your sat-nav, you have a light that just flashes across the dash just up there to get your attention, to tell you you're about to have to make a manoeuvre, and it'll actually flash in the direction you've got to go. Probably won't bloody do it now. Come on, ID, don't let me down. Maybe at the next junction it'll do it. I can't even use the cruise control now because this system's gone crazy. Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. One thing I haven't done is seen what this car's like for overtaking on the motorway. It's actually pretty good. In fact, I better back off because now I'm going quite quickly. I thought this light would flash to tell me to get off and follow the sat-nav. It's not done it. Is this car a bit glitchy? I wonder if it'll do it here at the roundabout. Nope. Just had a little warning pop up saying, please charge vehicle because they've got 50 miles of range left. I'm not charging at 50 miles, that's loads. Look, 20% of battery, it's all fine. That was interesting, look at that there. The car knows that there is a hill in front of me and a change of speed. So it's telling me to lift off the accelerator because I can just coast. It's all designed to help maximize the efficiency. Now I've put motorway service station into the satellite navigation for two reasons. One, I want to turn this car off and on again, see if I can reset it like a computer, maybe fix this glitch. Also, because I want to see if it'll do that thing with the ID light just at the top of the dash, whether it'll tell me to get off. Are you going to work? Come on, ID light. So it's come up with the satellite navigation with the direction there. Where's my ID light? Nothing. Absolutely bloody nothing. While the ID3 is having a rest to get itself together, let's talk about its boot capacity. So there is 385 litres of space, which is 5 litres more than you get in a normal conventional Golf. But you can still fit the same 5 airplane-sized carry-on suitcases in its boot. I have tried to fit 6 in there, but it won't fit properly. Anyhow, let's get all this stuff out of the boot so I can show you some of the features. Bear with me. Right. So, as you'll see, it's a nice square shape. There are a few tie-down points. You've got a 12-volt socket here and some hooks to hang your bags off. Now, I'll just remove the parcel shelf. And I guess if you're a regular to this channel, you'll know what's coming now. If I fold the seats down, which is easy to do, you'll see that there's a ridge there. That's annoying. Now, you can get this car with a false floor, which reduces the load lip and gets rid of that ridge. But this doesn't have it. And that brings you on to 5 annoying things about the ID3. The driver only has one switch to control the front and back window for each side of the car. So this controls the right front, but it also controls the right rear. I just have to press this button to put it into rear mode. And now look, I can make the back one go up. Why don't they just fit more switches rather than this stupid palaver? Whose idea was that? Look how small this glove box is. The reason is that while Volkswagen moved the steering wheel across to the right for the UK market, they didn't move the fuse box. It's under there. That's the kind of stunt that Peugeot pulls. If you have this car with a 77 kilowatt hour battery pack, then it's a strict two-seater here in the back rather than this three-seater bench. It might be because the extra batteries take up space under here, so you can't sit anyone there. The brakes on electric cars can sometimes be a little bit jerky when you're manoeuvring. They're not on this, they're smooth, but they do make a noise occasionally when you stop. Hear that? The design of these door pockets are a little bit confusing. You see, they actually extend way beyond the opening. So you might think, I've lost my keys, I wonder if they're in the door pocket. So you look in, no, they're not in there, look. Whereas in fact, yes they are, right in the corner. It's not all negative though. Here's 5 good things about this car. Got triplets and need to carry 3 baby seats? No problem, you get ISOFIX anchor points even here on the front passenger seat. Are you pretty rubbish at parking and have lots of car park prangs? Well, don't worry, this car will automatically brake if it thinks you're going to drive into something in the car park.
Do you like a bit of ambience in your car? Well, the ID3 has various light themes for the interior. Look, desire, euphoria, vitality. Is there one called dysentery? I don't know, but you can also just choose it yourself and go for different colours that you prefer. Look, yep. Oh, choice.
If you're buying this car for environmental reasons, you'll be pleased to know that the seats are made from 20% recycled materials. Also, Volkswagen has paid to offset any carbon produced during the manufacture of this car, so it's actually carbon neutral.
This car has a proper keyless go system, so you don't have to do anything really, you just get in, it senses that you're there with the key, there's a pressure sensor in the seat, knows you sat down, and then all I have to do to start the car is put my foot on the brake, engage drive, and off I go. Now when I want to get out, I just put it into park mode, get out, and it'll turn itself off. Yeah? Look at that. Now, there is actually a starter button, but that's just there for old time's sake. Well, I think the car has had long enough to reset itself. No, front assist availability is limited. Awesome. Error lane assist. Is that your lot? Oh, aerodynamic cornering light as well. Anything else while we're at it? No. All right, let's get on with this. Before I run out of charge, I want to see what this car is like to drive on a twisty road. Now, it could be good fun because the motor is at the back. It's rear-wheel drive. So I'm going to put the car into sports mode now. Yes, it has a sports mode. That should sharpen at the throttle response and... Ooh, yeah, it's pretty zippy. But what about the handling? I mean, this thing does weigh 1.8 tonnes, so it's a bit lardy for a family hatchback. I mean, you can blame the batteries for that, but because they're mounted low, you've got a low centre of gravity, so it doesn't lean too much when you chuck it into a bend. The only problem is that you can't really feel how much grip the front wheels have got through this steering. It's just all a bit remote, which is fine really in a car like this. You're not wanting a sports car, and it does just grip the road well enough. The only problem is the fact that the suspension always seems a little bit busy. It's like constantly jiggling about over the rough surface. You don't want to push it too fast because it just doesn't feel quite planted enough. It's fine though for however people are going to drive this car. Oh look, it's just flipped over onto 10% of battery remaining. It says I've got 26 miles of range left. So I've done 181 miles so far, and averaging 3.8 miles per kilowatt still. Please charge your vehicle. You can search for a charging station nearby. I think I'm going to cancel that. Oh, there we go. Look, it's just flipped over to 5% of battery remaining. I've got 11 miles left of range. You know, I'm not stressed. There's something about this car. It's just relaxing. It's nice and pleasant and comforting to travel in. Okay, I'm rapidly running out of range, so I'm going to get off the motorway here and head to a charger that I know is about 4 or 5 miles away. Oh, I've got 1% of battery remaining, 2 miles of range. I don't seem to have any loss in power, and I haven't got any warnings or anything on the driver's display. Oh no, it's just clocked over to 0% battery. So at zero, I've done 203 miles. No percent of battery, no miles of range. Yeah, I don't seem to have any loss in performance. Oh, no range remaining. Charge vehicle now. 205 miles now, so 2 miles driven when I've got no percent of battery and no range. Performance is restricted. Please consult vehicle wallet. Oh, we've got the turtle sign up. Now it's not feeling quite as quick as before. 210 miles now. Oh, here we go. Only maneuvering possible. Please charge, consult vehicle wallet. Oh no, I'm totally dying. It's really coasting steadily to a stop. I better put my hazards on so the guys behind know I'm about to break down. At least I'm in town. What's going to happen now when I go around here? Is it going to just suddenly stop? Is it going to shut down now I've come to a stop? That's it. That's my lot. I'm rolling backwards. Right. Can I move? No. So that was good. It slowed me down quite gradually. It warned me about the problems that I was having. And it's left me with the ability to use the power steering and to push it. Okay then. Let's push him out of the way. Just get it up the curb. It's good that it lets you do this. They've obviously thought about it, the whole kind of running out of charge process. So 210 miles that I manage on 94% battery, so that's about 220 if it had been 100% battery. 40 miles off the claimed 260 miles, but there you go, it's not too bad. Now, if you'd like to see how some other cars did when I drove them until they ran out of battery, click on the pop-out banner up there to watch my video. Right, now what do I do now? Oh, I know. The RAC actually has a service where they come out specifically to stricken electric vehicles, and they can charge them at the roadside to get you moving so you can get to a proper fast charger. So I'm just going to make that call. I've just realised that this car is letting me manoeuvre. Look, there's life in the old dog yet. I'm not giving up until it's completely flat. I wonder if it'll let me drive around here. Come on. Come on. Yes. Come on, there's nothing there. There's no power. Come on, come on, come on. I am definitely driving. Oh, 211 miles. Oh no, this is definitely it. This is the end. Yeah, it's totally dead, but it is rolling still. Let's roll over there safely off the road. And I think that really is it now. And I'd say that that is definitely the end of that. So in the end, we did 211 miles. And when you adjust that for the fact that I started with 94% battery, it works out to 224 miles. And really, guys, look, I think this time it really is it. Oh, look, the ID light's working. Now it comes alive. Well done, ID light. Thanks for finally turning up. Anyway, let's call the RAC and get a charge. I can actually drive to a proper charging station. So the RAC has connected their van up to my car. They're charging it at 3 kilowatts, which is about the same as you get from a normal 3-pin socket. So it's quite slow, but it's enough to give me a few miles range so I can get to that charging point. Obviously, if I was further from a charging point, I'd just have to wait it out, but it's better than being completely stranded. And if worse comes to the worst, they can actually tow the car. But I don't want to do that. I want to drive it to the charging point. They're actually working on improving the actual kilowatt output of their backup chargers to 7 kilowatts, so the same as a Wallbox home charger. Oh look, the ID light is working for the charging as well. After leaving the car charging on the RAC van for 30 minutes, it had enough power to drive to a proper charger. But please remember, I ran out of battery on purpose. The reality is the ID3's real world range is easily enough to suit most people's needs. The only real inconvenience of it and other electric cars is that they take longer to refuel than a petrol or diesel car. Now, as standard, this car can charge at 50 kilowatts, but this particular model is able to actually charge at 100 kilowatts, and it can charge from empty to 80% full in half an hour. So charging at 50 kilowatts, it's probably going to take an hour to get to 80% full. You can even get the car with a 125 kilowatt charging capacity, though that'd be pointless most of the time. So then, what's my final verdict on the new Volkswagen ID3? Should you avoid it? Should you consider it? Should you shortlist it? Or should you just go right ahead and buy it? I reckon you should shortlist it. It's not perfect, but it's still a really good all-round electric car. Hello again, it's a new day. Change of clothes. And the ID3 has had a new lease of life. It's the classic, turn it off, leave it for a long time, and turn it back on again, and everything will be fine. The error messages have gone. The sensors are working. The car is happy again. Oh, modern tech, eh?